I don't care how late you stay out. Stay out as late as you want. You want to borrow the new car? You want to borrow my credit card? Kids today, they really have it rough.
I have no idea where we are or where we're going.
I mean, when I was their age, life was easy. Super easy. Why haven't you gotten a tattoo yet? How come you don't have any piercings yet?
Yep, we're lost. We are completely lost.
Ooh, sports.
Just do whatever the mechanic says to do.
Vehicle maintenance is completely overrated.
Look, whatever the mechanic is asking, just pay him. Pay him whatever he wants.
I wish they had soap operas at night. I like that boy. You should date him. You should date him immediately.
Well, what about the creepy guy with the motorcycle? He's cute.
Yeah, sure. Spring break in Tahiti sounds fun. Hey, make sure you get all your video games done before you start your homework. You don't have to pass all your classes.
What? You have a project due tomorrow, and you've known about it for 4 weeks, and you haven't started yet? Sweet!
Doesn't anybody want to know if we're there yet?
Remember, if you need anything between midnight and 4 a.m., please come wake me up.
Hey, I'm on the phone. Could you bring the baby over and let him climb all over me?
Hey! Hey, can you please turn that music up?
Well, we just stopped for lunch 10 minutes ago, but yeah, let's stop again. I never have trouble with my toddler.
I never have trouble with my teenagers.
I never have trouble with my adult children.
You know, she's right. We are ruining her life.
Yes, more homework to correct.
All right, whining.
Yay, tantrums.
Vomit.
We just really need to spoil these kids more.
Sorry, buddy. I don't know any good jokes at all.
You're 16. You pretty much know everything now.
I think 18's a great age to get married.
Okay, remember, make sure you turn on all the lights before you leave the house.
Hey, could you leave the front door open for a couple hours? Thanks.
Right? Oh my goodness. Well, good morning and happy Father's Day to you. How many of you want to praise the Lord for bacon today? Anybody? A little praise for some bacon. Man, that would taste good this morning. Thank you guys for all of your work and putting that together for us and just to be able to enjoy that this morning. This first song, as we join in together, I want us to think about the simple phrase that says, "You are God alone," even this morning. In the Young Adults Bible Study, we talked about Colossians chapter 1, and several verses there just talks about all of this thought that there is no one greater than God. So this morning, let's sing it out. You are not a God created by human hands. You are not a God dependent on any mortal man. You are God alone. Let's sing it together. Here we go.
You are not a God created.
You're unchangeable.
God alone, and I'm looking forward to our Sunday nights together as we get into some of our groups and studies. And so many of our groups on these Sunday nights are going to be time for close fellowship. But I want you to make sure you get signed up for those, because as we worship this morning, those sessions will all have something in them that will help our worship. Because anytime we grow in who God is, we're growing in our worship. Can you say amen? Anytime I'm growing in my personal walk, I'm growing in my worship. So don't forget to sign up for those. If you've not done that yet, be sure and do that and join us tonight. We're looking forward to that. I wanted to share a verse with you this morning. Psalms 54 in verse 4, it says, "Behold, God is my helper." He says, look closely. I want you to see that God is helping me. How many of you had God's help this week? Say amen. You had God's help. You experienced it. You felt it. And even maybe today you've experienced that this morning, that he's been your help. I love a couple verses later. It says, "I will freely sacrifice unto thee." Look at me just for a minute. What David is saying in this psalm, he's saying to you, God, you have not required this sacrifice of me, but I'm freely giving this sacrifice to you. And so this morning, I want you to give that sacrifice of praise together. But I want you to think about other things that you could sacrifice for your Lord today. It says, "I freely sacrifice unto thee. I will praise thy name, O God, for it is good." And isn't his name good? Amen. And so this morning, as we continue to worship, think about his name and who he is this morning. As we think about this next song, "How Great Is Our God."
The splendor of the King is clothed in majesty. Let all the earth rejoice. Let all the earth rejoice. He wraps himself in light. Oh, and darkness tries to hide and trembles at his voice.
Sing with me, how great is our God.
is our God, and all will see how great is our God.
How deep the Father's love for us.
Father's love for us, thou vast beyond all measure, that he should give his only son to make a wretch his treasure. How great the pain of searing
something to reflect. And on this next and our last song this morning, you may be seated. In this song, it speaks of you alone, and I've asked Marion this morning to lead us in this last song, the first verse and the second verse. I asked him just to sing it for us so we could absorb the words. And so will you join me this morning with just maybe when he starts, just closing your eyes and absorbing those words and then joining in on that chorus.
And as well, I want you guys to just listen to this these couple of verses in Psalms 103, where it's talking to David, writing a psalm. It said, "Bless the Lord, O my soul, and all that is within me, bless his holy name. Bless the Lord, O my soul, and forget not all his benefits, who forgiveth all mine iniquities, who healeth all my diseases, who redeemeth thy life from destruction, who crowneth thee with loving kindness and tender mercies, who satisfy my mouth with good things, so that my youth is renewed like eagles." That's the Lord who we're singing about today. That's who we're worshiping today. So as I sing this here, like Matt said, just close your eyes and just let these words wash over you. Sing with us here. You
only one I need. I bow all of me at your feet. I worship you alone. You have given me more than I could ever have wanted, and I want to give you my heart and my soul. And you alone are Father, and you alone are good, and you alone are Savior, and you alone are God. I'm alive, 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 and you alone are Father, and you alone are good, and you alone are Savior, and you alone are God, and you alone are Father, and you alone are good, and you alone are Savior, and you alone are God.
Sing that chorus one more time, but let's do it real softly. I want to do it as a prayer. You probably don't even need the words this morning. Think about that. You alone. If we're thinking about him as a father, I'm going to ask Julie to make her way this morning. If you would go ahead and come, Julie, she's got a song for us this morning, but just sing that chorus. You alone, our Father. Here we go.
You alone, our Father, and you alone, our good. You alone, our Savior, and you alone are God.
I just went to a wonderful place this last couple weeks. We're in Israel. We got to see where everything that we do here started there. It blows your mind. It really does. But what was sad was because all these churches were there and people were bowing and touching, thinking that was their salvation, without realizing that that was just the start of their salvation, was where they went. That he, not that he was born there, but that he was born. Not that he died there, but he died. Not that he arose there, but that he arose for us. He's a good father. He made a way for our salvation, and he sent his only son to do that. For that, I praise him, and I can say, you are a good, good father.
Oh, I've heard a thousand stories of what they think your life, but I heard the tender whisper of love in the dead of night, and you tell me that you're pleased and that I'm never alone. You're a good, good father. It's who you are. It's who you are. It's who you are, and I'm loved by you. It's who I am.
It's who I am. It's who I am. I've seen many searching for answers far and wide, but I know we're all searching for answers. Only you provide, 'cause you know just what we need before we say a word. You're good, good Father. It's who you are. It's who you are. It's who you are. And I'm loved by you. Oh, it's who I am. Who I am, who I am. You're perfect in all of your ways, Lord, you're perfect in all of your ways. Lord, you're perfect in all of your ways to us. You are perfect in all of your ways. You're perfect in all of your ways. You are perfect in all of your ways to us. Love so undeniable, I can hardly speak. Peace so unexplainable, I can hardly think, 'cause you tell me that I'm loved, and I can go deeper still than you call me, deeper still into love, love, love. You're a good, good Father. It's who you are. It's who you are. And I'm loved by you. It's who I am. It's who I am. It's who I am. You're a good, good Father. It's who you are. It's who you are. It's who you are. And I'm loved by you. It's who I am. It's who I am. It's who I am. You're a good, good Father. It's who you are. It's who you are. I'm loved by you. It's who I am. It's who I am. You're perfect in all of your ways. You are perfect in all of your ways. Lord, you're perfect in all of your ways to us. A good, good Father. You are good. You are perfect.
Happy birthday, Milton Gray, wherever you are out in that land. There you are. And your family, and you. Happy birthday. Just go straight to the billfold. Amen. Are we on now, man? I'm sorry you couldn't hear all that I said so far. Thank you, Matt, for helping me out. I owe him more than I... Can you pay my debt to him? I need some help getting even with Matt. Amen. We're glad that you're here. We really, really are happy you're here. And for you that are guests with us, thank you for being a part. Connect with us, not only in card and information, but come and check us out. You'll find that we love the Lord and we'll love you. We'll walk you, walk as we walk together in our life's journey together. It's a great, great crowd. How many feel sorry for the pigs this morning? I mean, enjoyed the bacon this morning, amen? That's good. That's great. We're going to read Exodus. The story involves where Joseph had died. Israel now is in bondage to Egypt. And everything the Egyptians do, they multiply and they're blessed. It's because who they are, and they're blessed. So the Pharaoh, the new Pharaoh, is frightened and fearful because he thinks that Israel's going to join in with their enemies if there's a battle, and they will lose and they'll be set free. So they said, man, I got a plan. And what I'm going to do is we're going to stifle the generations of Israel, and we're going to kill all the male babies. And so he mandated that the midwives would kill every male baby of the Jew of Israel's line. But they wouldn't do it. They said, we get there, and the male babies, the Jewish babies, are lively, they said, and they're born before we get there. They don't have any trouble. They just come and start running. They're just, from the beginning, they're just... He said, you guys got to do that. So he mandated that every male baby would be thrown into the river. And he knew that would solve the problem. Abortion was not new to our era of time. Amen? It wasn't. But God always judges a nation that destroys their babies. But we find ourselves in Exodus 2 now, and Brother Brandon is going to come and read these first 10 verses for me to save some of my words this morning. But would you stand, please, with us this morning in love and honor to the Lord? I just get comfortable, and the pastor wants you to stand. I understand that. But this morning, I want you to take a minute to begin to adjust your heart and tell him you love him and love his word. Brandon, come and lead us in a word of prayer. Excuse me, in our reading of the word.
Exodus chapter 2, verse 1 to 10. The Bible says, and there went a man of the house of Levi and took to wife a daughter of Levi. And the woman conceived and bare a son. And when she saw him, that he was a goodly child, she hid him 3 months. And when she could not longer hide him, she took for him an ark of bulrushes and daubed it with slime and with pitch and put the child therein. And she laid it in the flags by the river's brink. And his sister stood afar off to wit what would be done to him. And the daughter of Pharaoh came down to wash herself at the river. And her maidens walked along by the river's side. And when she saw the ark among the flags, she sent her maid to fetch it. And when she had opened it, she saw the child, and behold, the babe wept. And she had compassion on him and said, this is one of the Hebrews' children. Then said his sister to Pharaoh's daughter, shall I go and call to thee a nurse of the Hebrew women, that she may nurse the child for thee? And Pharaoh's daughter said to her, go. And the maid went and called the child's mother. And Pharaoh's daughter said unto her, take this child away, and nurse it for me, and I will give thee thy wages. And the woman took the child and nursed it. Verse 10, and the child grew, and she brought him unto Pharaoh's daughter, and became her son. And she called his name Moses, and she said, because I drew him out of the water.
And Father, add your blessing to your word in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you. Be seated, please. Every man can become a great father. Our beginnings are not all the same. We can't choose where we start, but we can choose what we become. Not many men have had an ideal start. She and I will talk about our lives pretty open. We both had great mothers. Our fathers had some real challenges, but one unique thing about both of our fathers was that our fathers both loved us. They didn't know how to show it. They didn't have all the pieces together of how to live, but they loved us. It was unique. Moses was a very unique man. Abortion was a government plan for him. The medical people, my friend, were commanded to follow and execute it out, but they didn't do it with him. And so he had a different story taken by the faith of his mother and father, put in a little boat, slid in the river, picked up by the Pharaoh's wife, raised, if you please, in the home of the leader of the land. You know, your obstacles of being a father are very real. And some of what where we came from and what we come through make us what we are. But Moses was unique and very different in the fact that he had, just like you and so like me, so many had different obstacles to overcome. But at the very same time, he overcome them and become the man called the friend of God. Amram, I had to think about him. That's Moses' father's name, Amram. I wonder if he drove Dodge vehicles. I've just wondered, aimed Ford, you know, trucks, you know. And Jochebed. They started by the law of God, not by the government law. They started their family and began to raise this man and this father one day, not by culture, but by God's law. Not by generational law and what was convenient and popular, but by God's law. That's who they were. And that's began the place where Moses' life started. You know, they were at a short timeline, and they knew it. And so if you're this morning here and you have children in the nursery, the last few weeks we've had brand new babies here. There's second week in church. That the Inman babies always get started spiritual quick. Been here a couple, out of the hospital a couple weeks and been here both services, amen. And Paul's got another baby girl, so we need to have another boy to get caught up to find, I don't know where Paul's at in here with another baby girl. But it's interesting, they're on a short timeline and didn't know it. And you and I must realize that raising children seems to be a long time, but it's a very short timeline. If any of your children are 12 years of age or younger, you realize that you spent two-thirds of the time that you have to train them already with them. In other words, you only have one-third of the time to spend your life with them on the average as it goes. It's very interesting that there's not a lot of time. They were in a short timeline and they knew it. And you know what? They started early with Moses. You find that Moses was committed to his physical, biological mother to nurture him. I've often wondered how long she had to train and to teach him. How long did they have? How much time to put truth within them? How much, what did they do? When did they start? You know, it's interesting as we think about our children. They're in such a critical time in their life. You know, we used to deal with a racial prejudice in our society and community, but now we're dealing with things as never before. The critical race theory. In third grade now, they're wanting our children to determine what sex they are or what animal they are. We have about six high schools that attend our church in the region. But it's not a secret, and you know it like I do. There's two kids now that believe they're cats. They don't believe they're a human, they believe they're cats. Now, within the sound of my voice, and youths will drive by the schools and where they happen, they believe they're kitties. They believe they're cats. One of the bus drivers told me here a month ago, said, you know, the parents are having trouble because they're trying to figure out how to build a litter box for their children. And they got names for themselves. You say, Pastor, that's so far out. Well, we also have got two kids that believe they're helicopters, and so they'll be going around the hall, go around in circles. I do that, but I'd fall down right now, so I'm not going to do that. What are you trying to say? They knew that they had a short time to deal with this baby boy. They were not even permitted to give his official name to him. The official name would come from the Pharaoh's wife. I drew him out of the water, Moses. They knew they had a very short timeline, and what they put in him was so important. What we teach is so important. You know, just a way of making our way through the Word of God. You know, we must think of how and what we teach our children. Shall we teach them how to eat fish? Our generation has taught them how to eat fish. You go to the mailbox and you get the check and you go to the store and you buy the fish. You can teach them how to buy the fish or you can teach them how to catch the fish. Do you understand the difference in teaching? So we have a generation now that knows how to eat fish, but they're not sure how to catch them. Say, Pastor, it's very offensive to this generation to say that. My desire is not to please the generation, my brother and my sister. My desire is to please God. My concern is not about a crowd of people. My concern is about a people, my friend, that I've committed myself to, that I would teach them to live their life and have a good life that's got to be God's way. We must teach them truth. We have underestimated the truth of God. We've made all kind of efforts to attract and get and bring and have, but it's the truth that makes the difference. It's the truth. It's the truth as we sang with the songs. It's the truth as Miss York sung with her voice. We have made chasing a ball more important than catching the truth. We made sitting in a bleacher more important than sitting in the house of God. Can anybody say amen to that one? Sir? I say we. I didn't say the world. I didn't say, my friend, the system. I said we, the people of God. We have made listening to the world more important than listening to the Word of God. Any man can be a good father. Any man can be a good father. Let me give you some ingredients. Four ingredients I find that Moses had. We're going to reflect on the story in Exodus chapter 3. First of all, one of the ingredients that stood out far in his life and the fact that, my friend, that he literally knew who he was. There's no question about it. He knew that he was different than the Egyptian. He was not better than them, but he was different than them. Who you are and where you are not the same. In other words, yes, he was a Jew, but he was in bondage as a slave to the Egyptians, but he was different than the Egyptian because he was one of God's chosen people. And the reflection and the picture and the image is, my friend, that you are a born-again son of God. Once you realize who you are, you find that you will never fit in that same place where you're at. He knew who he was, and he was unique, and he was different, and it stood up very, very early in his life. So now he had grown, the Bible says, and as he grown, he went out to check out the bondage of his people. And as he gets there, he finds that one of the Egyptians were having a hard time, and there was words between Moses and the Egyptian, and the Moses did pretty good, and the Egyptian didn't do very good. There was a big sand pile that looked a little different there. You say, Pastor Lamb, that is, I don't think that was right. That was so extreme. You know, we've lost the balance of the Old and the New Testament. We've lost the balance of our generation. We lost our direction. Yeah. You know, this last guy that went into our schools and shot our babies, shot two of our teachers. You know, we heard a bit about him, and then his name was put away. I'm pretty public here, but can I tell you something that would change everything? If you just take that coward and you take off his bulletproof vest, he's a coward. He was a coward. They're not heroes. They're cowards. You know, they don't come through the front door. They look through a side door. They're cowards. Cowards. They don't want anybody to hurt them, but they want to hurt others. Can I tell you what changed everything? You say, Pastor, are you going to say this? I thought about it. I think I'm going to say it. I say, Pastor, I don't know that I'm even going to like it. I'm not asking to like it. I'm just telling you it will change a generation. You take that man, you get a big sign of his name, and you take him to the public square, and you hang up there and let the bird eat out of him a while, and his innards run out and squish around the ground. You do that in a few cities, and I'll tell you what those boys will say. Now, should I? Am I going to? Yeah, you come to Hillsboro during the millennium and try something like that with me, and your bones will be on the county square. You say, Pastor, you are so barbaric. How can you say them things? How can you do that? Why would you say that? I'm saying there's something about, my friend, the law, the fear, and there's nothing there. Can I say that truth is so important? He knew who he was. There was no question about who he was. And he wasn't what he was because of the land he was in. He wasn't what he was because of he was a slave. He was what he was because of what God put in his heart. You say, Pastor, that's barbaric. Well, you forget that part of the sermon. It'll get better in just a bit, okay? But then he stood for right. Oh, man. He ended up in Midian, and it just so happened he ended up to meet the priest's daughters of Midian. And the Bible said that the girls were gathering water, and they were feeding and watering the sheep. And the shepherds had come in, run off them young ladies, and said, no, it's our turn. No, we're going to use your water. You draw it, but let us. You wait after us. They got home early, and Dad said, why are you guys back so early? Said there was a man there. Oh, I like that word. I said there was a man there. Did you hear that? Amen. Have you ever seen any man? They wear big boy pants, Brother Craig. Big boy pants. Amen. Big boy. In the morning, they don't get up and put their linens on. They get up and put the man's pants on. Doesn't say he was 6 foot tall. He just put on a man pants. That's all he did. The real shortage these days of man's pants. I went to buy a pair of jeans, you know. Siggy said, now, them not so stylish, Dad. The girls told me, said, Dad, they pay as much for those jeans as you do for a suit. I got some of them jeans, and they were stretchy, man. I thought I had a pair of girls' britches. I wasn't sure. They were stretchy. Can I say there was a man there, Daddy? Why did you ask me? How come I got home early? He said, there was a man there, and he ran off the shepherds. It's interesting. He stood for right. He stood for right when he could, where he should. Now that's interesting. Amen. Say the enemy's big. The enemy has nothing to do with the challenges of life. What has something to do is, my friend, is the size of the pants that the man wears. I like to shake a man's hand, don't you? Amen. Oh, I may like to be around men. Now, you girls can't say that right now. You can't. Brother Ron, you got a hold of her? Missy, do you like to be around your man? Can you say amen, Missy? Oh, man, I didn't have to prompt that. Amen. Karen, how about you? You like being around your man? A little quiet, but she shook her head. There was a man there, Daddy, and he ran off the shepherds, and we watered the sheep. Said, why'd you guys leave him out there? Go get that dude. We haven't seen a man like that in a while. It's been a while since the world's seen a man, you know. I get a little barbaric, a little ornery, a little country come out of me, a little Old Testament come out of me, a little Christian comes out of me. It'd be really good that a whole lot of Christian be come out of the men of the Hillsboro Church, wouldn't you say amen? I mean, that when they look at him, said, no, he don't have them stretch jeans on. No, he's got big boy pants on, man. Amen. He stood for right. The agreement was he knew who he was, and he stood for right. Yeah, here's another one. I won't stay here very long. He respected his ladies, the ladies that were around him. Not the ladies that he knew. Not that he called by name, not that it was his family, not that it was his neighbors. No, he just come across them, and he just was a man that had a real respect for ladies. But here's my message, and it won't be long. Are you ready? Let me give it to you. He let God work in his life. Any man can be a great father. Any man can be a great father. Any man can be a great father. God didn't give you a test. God didn't give you a chest to see if you had enough credentials to become a father. He said, no, you follow my plan. You be holy until you find your wife, and then you have your wife, and then you have to have your wife. You want to have children. I was in therapy, and nurse was behind me in the front. She's running some tests. said, we got talking about family, said, well, tell me about you. I said, well, I met my wife when she was 15. I married when she's 18. Her father signed off. Said, you guys are messing around. You understand what that means, right? I said, no, we weren't messing around, but Shiggy said we wanted to, so we got married first. Amen. Please take some of this video and throw it far, far away. She kissed me and I said, can we get married tomorrow? You say, Pastor, what happened to you with that stroke? That wasn't in my notes. Amen. Get this, watch this. You want to be the man? You want to be the man of big boy pants. I found that you never stop being a father. And it's never a good plan. It's never a God's plan. No, that's my baby daddy. Say, Pastor, what has happened to you? You're not appeasing the generation, the crowd. Somebody needs to tell somebody that it's not the way to do it. You say it's offensive. I'm sorry to being offense to you, but I am pleading for the souls of those other baby daddies. I'm pleading because you'll not reap it, they'll reap it, and they'll have to live with it. There's never been a shortage of men like there is today. There's never been. There's just never been a shortage. You say, well, there are 45 minutes. There are 45 minutes laying in wait for the SWAT team to come. Give me a gun. Give me a knife. Give me a stick. If my babies are in that school, don't arrest me. Stand back from me. I'm going after the man. We just will say, Pastor, you've probably been killed. I'd have done right. And you know what? That's the men of the Hillsboro Church. You say, Pastor, what happened to you? You know, any man can be a good daddy. Got to get to this message. I've only got a few minutes left. First of all, we find that he welcomed God's visits. We find that he was tending the sheep. He's 40 years of age now. That's interesting, isn't it? 40 years of age, and he's in the mountain of God, Mount Moriah, called the mountain of God. That's where he's at, tending the sheep. And the angel of the Lord speaks unto him. And as he speaks unto him, immediately and quickly, he responds. God speaks to us more than we know. And he was a man that could hear God as God spoke to him. It was not the first time. It was the time when it was recorded. We find that if he's going to be the man that God wanted to be, then we need to let God work in his life. And he did by welcoming him God's visits. Number two, he listened to God speak. And as God would speak his will to his heart, my friend, he obeyed him. He listened to him. And as God bargained, my friend, with the heart of Moses, he listened to him. You see, it wasn't because he had a thorough and complete upbringing. It was simply because, my friend, he was equipped with the truth to be able to listen to God, welcome God's visits. And if you listen and you welcome, God will do his work in you. You are not where you are, but God will keep you where you are. God will take you where you need to be as he visits and you listen. And then he reverenced God's presence. It always changes you. You welcome God visiting, you listen to what he has to say, and then you reverence his presence. The first thing it is, he took off his shoes. Took off his shoes. I read this week. It said, you don't know why a father wears takes an extra pair of socks when he goes golfing. Person said, I don't know why a golfer, a dad, takes an extra pair of socks when he goes golfing. Said, in case he gets a hole in one. You guys are on the ball this morning now, I'm telling you what. Amen. He took off his shoes. Here's something that amazes me. He had so much, listen, he had so much respect for God's presence. Should I say this or no? He had so much respect for God's presence, he was careful not to distract his service when the Word of God was being preached. He was careful, my friend, to honor God's presence. He not only, number one, remember he took off his shoes. Number two, he wouldn't even look to the face of God. You read the scripture, chapter number 3. He wouldn't even look at God because of fearful. To look into the face of God. He had a respect for the very presence of God and the voice of God as it was touching his heart and moving in his life. There was a reverence and a respect for God. And lastly, not dumb, he became what God needed him to become. God said, okay, now Moses, Israel's in this condition, but here's what I need you to do. He said, I got some problems, God. I got some human frail problems. So I'll take care of the problems. You'd be willing to go. Moses said, sign me up. I'm ready to go. Let's go. Anybody. Any man that wants to be a good father can be. I'm not done being a good father. God's not done with me. God wants to visit me. He wants to speak to me. He wants me to reverence him. He wants me to do what he wants me to do. A good father begins every day. You know, a father doesn't become a good father and then he's done and he's there and it's over. No, no. Every morning he gets up and puts on the same pair of big pants. Puts on the same pair of big pants and said, God, I welcome you to visit. I'll listen as you speak. I'll reverence you and I'll do what you want me to do. God has desired to make men one day at a time. It's so sweet. So God said, I'm going to visit you. I'm going to speak to you. I want you to honor me. And I want you to become what I tell you. Wow. You'll win every time. You'll win every time. I can remember the first time I ever shot a rifle at 200 yards. And you couldn't tell I shot 2 shells. I first of all thought I missed the whole target the second shot. But you know what? I put one inside the other. I never, only did that one time. You know what I know? I've missed a lot of shots. I've been off mark a whole lot spiritually. But you know what? Every morning it starts all over. I'm going to visit you, son. Will you listen to me? Will you respect what I say, and then will you become what I want you to do? So this morning, if you're not saved, you see, I was religious as a young man, but not saved. I played on the ball team. I got to wheelbarrow full of whiskey for the summer event in the church. Oh, yeah. 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 But I was unsaved. And the priest didn't know how to get there, so how could he ever help me to get there? I say, Pastor Lamb, you're so clear. Yeah, well, it kind of hit my head a little bit. You know what? Somebody needs to tell the truth to a generation that's hungry for truth. Can't wait for truth. You know, God wants to visit us, and he has. God wants to speak to us, and he does. God wants to reverence him, and that's you and I. And then God wants us to become what he wants us to become. Now it's up to you and me. You know, we have an invitation. This generation that bothers them. Very influent people some years ago came to church and said, Pastor, we love the church, man. We enjoy and love you. Said, if you wouldn't have that invitation, we'd come. Said, man, we'd love to have you come. We enjoy you. But guess what? It's not mine. It's God's invitation. It's God pleading for souls, lives, homes, kids. And he'll speak. And if we don't answer quick, will forget the importance, will leave our hearts, and will not say yes to God. So I won't. And God bless you as you go on. And that was the last time they came. But it's not the last time God spoke. Because he's still speaking, and he's still changing lives, and he's still making a difference to those that will say, I will. That's who God is. Stand with me, would you please? Father in heaven, we thank you for your word and the way you make big daddies. Thank you, Lord, for the way you take a simple man when you visit with him, that will listen, that will reverence, that will say yes to you and make him a good daddy. Make him a good husband. Make him a good man. Thank you, Lord, that you are in the making business, taking a piece of human nothing, broken, sinful, visiting him, speaking to him. Give me a chance to respond and then changing him. Father, move in the hearts of our families and our church. Lord, might the men put on big pants and say, Pastor Lamb, I've heard about Jesus being the Savior, and I want him to be my Savior. I want him to change my life. I want him to change me. I want to be in heaven someday. Lord, I pray that you would help now and bless now with your Holy Spirit. Might heaven come down and salvation fill the souls of lost people. Have your way in Jesus' name and for his sake. And amen. And amen. We're going to sing an invitation. You hear the instrument playing. I first of all ask to begin with you, with the men. Wouldn't it be something if a daddy would say, today's going to be the day I'm going to give my heart to Jesus. Today's going to be the day. I'm not going to be talked out of it. I'm not going to be turned around. I'm not going to be stalled or staggered. No, today's going to be the day I'm going to give my heart to Jesus. Be something if he reaches over, his wife is beside him, said, would you go with me? Your husband's going to get saved. Wouldn't it be something that he said, okay. To his kid, daddy's going to get saved today. What a day, Father's Day. What a day to be saved. Wouldn't it be something if a mother said, not this time, I'm not going out unsaved. I'm going to settle it today. I'm going to settle it today. Ladies, salvation in my family began with my mama. My mama was a spiritual leader. That's where it began with mom. That's where it began. Let it begin with you. Don't let this day pass because God visited, because God spoke, because God waits for our response and he wants to make you and me. Let's say yes to the Lord. Let's build a strong home. Let's build a holy home. Let's build lives that will change lives after we've walked across. Let's say yes to the Lord in invitation song. You say yes to him. As we began to sing, Brother Marin, you lead us away. Won't you do that? You come because God speaks. You come because God moves. Give the Lord your heart.
my heart and my soul. And you alone are Father, and you alone are good, and you alone are Savior, and you alone are God, you alone are Father, and you alone are good, and you alone are Savior, and you alone are God.
He alone is Father, amen. He is alone as Father, and we're so grateful that God has allowed us to have that relationship with Him and to walk with Him every week that we have and to share that story. So I want to encourage you to share that story. Don't miss out on summer nights as they're approaching, starting tonight. How many of you are planning to be here tonight? Let me see your hand. Planning to be here tonight? Awesome. If you're not sure what group to go to, you can stop by the Welcome Center. In fact, I'm going to ask Dan York, if you will be there, I will be there. If you have questions about the groups, and maybe even those teachers could be there for us for a few minutes. If you have a question about one of the classes, one of those opportunities, be sure and stop by, talk to them, and get signed up for the one you think that will really meet the needs of your heart. In this time of our service, we do want to take a moment to pray over our offering in this time of worship, to thank Him for the opportunity to be able to not only have the country we live in and what we enjoy, but to have the jobs that we have, to earn what God has allowed us to earn and to give us those gifts. How many of you are glad you got a job? Say amen. And God has been good to us, and He is a good Father, as we've been singing so much about today. But let's ask God's blessing upon our offering. I know many of you give online. Thank you for doing that. Some of you in person, and some of you through the mail, but thank you for your gifts. God is watching your heart, and He knows your heart when we give to Him and when we obey Him. And so just like we said this morning with David's sacrifice, of his offering was above his normal offering, but I know that God is pleased when we give. So let's pray over that offering right now. Lord, we bring to You our hearts and our lives today, most importantly to give to You. But God, our hearts as we give financially, Lord, we know that that reflects the attitude of our heart, and we pray, God, that we would be obedient in our walk to provide for Your house and for Your kingdom and for the testimony to our community and to not only the city of our town, Hillsboro, but God, to the surrounding cities, as we just want to be that ripple of effect, Lord, to come from our hearts and not only our obedience to You, but Lord, it's about the gospel and getting the gospel to those cities around us. And God, we just ask, God, that You would do that through us. Pray, Lord, that we would easily speak Your name, and that, God, we would easily share what You have done in our hearts, Lord. So, Lord, give us more and more opportunities this week as we pray for those. But we pray for this offering today as we give, and as those have already done, we just thank You for those gifts of obedience to You. And as David said in that Psalm 54, that, God, we would give that sacrifice gift as well. So, Lord, may You be pleased with it. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. If you would, just remain for a minute. Dan has some announcements for us.
Yes, our upcoming events are this. I want to let you know, if you have signed up for LACA Media, that's Friday. This Friday at 4:15, they're going to be taking off for that. So all of our ladies that have signed up for that event to go and watch that, please be here at 4:15 or before that so we can get you on the bus and ready to go to that. That's Friday, 4:15. Also, we have a security team meeting at 2 o'clock at Kenny Creek Bomb's house this Saturday. And so if you are on the security team, or maybe you're interested in joining our security team, we'd love to have you, but we want to make sure and get you on that that security team meeting. There's so much information you need to gather there. So it's 2 o'clock this Saturday, and that'll be at Kenny Creek Bombs. And then, of course, our camp season is here. We have our camp, our teenagers, our 6th through 12th grade. We'll be leaving not this Monday, but next Monday. We'll be heading out for Camp Chautauqua and enjoying our Engage camp, and we're just going to have an amazing week. We still have some room on the bus, all right? And so if you have a student, 6th through 12th grade, that needs to go to camp, and I'm just going to say this, they all need to go to camp. Please come to me. We want to sign them up. I don't want to leave one student here if I can help it. And so please come sign up, come to me. You have my number there on the screen. You can text that to me, write that down, call me, and I will get your student on the bus. We want to make sure we don't leave anybody behind. It's going to be an amazing year, and I know God's going to do amazing things for our students there. And then the last one is this Splash Camp, August 1st through the 5th. That is for our little brothers and sisters there in our uprising kids. We want to take them and get them prepared for our Splash Camp. We run this camp, and so we want to take an amazing group and just have fun with them. And so please allow us to get them signed up soon so we can prepare for them. Maybe you're saying, once again, we say this every week, but you don't have a student or you don't have any students anymore, but you know that you want to invest in some lives of some students. Well, you can do that by helping us out with some of the costs. Some of these students aren't able to pay their own way or their parents aren't able to make that work for them at this point in time, but we can help invest in that life. And so maybe you want to sponsor a student, whether it's for Engage or Splash Camp, but we can take care of that. Just see me. Once again, text me, see me at the Welcome Center, and we can have that discussion and how we should move forward there. But for those camps, of course, $250 is the cost for our Engage camp, and then I believe it's $225 is the cost for Splash Camp this year. So I want to encourage you in that sponsorship. So that's all I have for you. Have a great afternoon. Happy Father's Day, dads. Go enjoy it, and we'll see you back tonight for AC Summer Nights.
You are God alone. Come before time.
Mega praise. We'll need you in the chapel real quick. Mega praise.
You are God.